So do you have any other questions before I get started?
No.
Oh, you're perfect. Okay, well, let's get started. Welcome everyone to Music Junkies. I'm your host, Annette Smith, and our guest today, I love that you said that, you struggle with recycling, right? You taught and talk in Tokyo for 4 years. You're from Indiana University. You went to Indiana University from California, which is awesome, with your beautiful wife and your children and your basset hound named Margaret Thatcher, which is awesome. Painting of the grand homes of California's Central Valley. And then, you know, obviously your great book that we're going to talk a lot about today, which is the Driftwood Tour, which is your very first novel. So I'm excited to have you, James Lane. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to talk about all this.
Yeah, I'm excited too. But before we get started, I always like to ask my guests, what was your experience putting your playlist together for me today?
So mine was all, to support the book. And as I was writing the book, I tried, because I was in bands, and this is about a band that's traveling around in the late 90s. And I realized, no matter how well I describe some song that they wrote, it's a fictional song and the readers are not going to really know, what I'm talking about. And so I thought, okay, well, what if I thought of, what if they did cover songs that everyone can go and even listen to? Even if they might be songs that everybody knows, right? Or they might be some obscure song that they could go out on YouTube and listen to it, and that can kind of play into that section of the story and make it funny or sad or make it more poignant. So I ended up with probably like 200 songs in a playlist, and I started to play with those and try to find songs that sounded similar to each other in different ways, or songs that meant a lot to me. And so yeah, and then I just narrowed it down from there. I don't know how many songs are actually in the book, but they're listed, and it's meant to be interactive. So you get to that section of the book and you go listen to that song. So there's different reasons for them. There's classical music in here. Most of it's rock and blues. There's there's Spanish music.
What
It's
a great
all
thing
over the board.
to do. Like a really unique way to read a book and then obviously listen and then implement music to listen to while you're reading the book. How did you come up with an idea like that?
Well, I call this book my love letter to musicians and to music lovers, because people are very, very passionate about music, right? And I thought of this character that you see here because I kind of became fascinated with. I'd heard the story of Jerry Garcia, who he'd gotten a car accident and couldn't remember how to play not only his own songs, he couldn't remember how to play music at all because of head trauma. And so I started to play with that, like, well, what if you forgot your own songs? And then what if you had to learn them from someone who hated your songs and didn't even know that you're the one who wrote it? Like, this guy, guitar teacher, just trying to teach you these songs and is wondering, like, why do you even like these songs? And that led into, okay, so this person cannot be all that famous, right? Because if the person doesn't like recognize who they are, they must not be that famous, right? So it all just kind of, and I just kind of worked backwards from there. And in the end, he ends up, learning his own songs from this young hotshot guitar player in Japan who thinks the music is horrible, doesn't know it's him. And so it's the guy who's living this very charmed life, and then his whole life just starts to unravel and gets worse and worse and worse. So the book gets, it gets pretty heavy towards the end, but there's redemption.
Yay, we like redemption, right?
Yes.
All right, we're gonna start with your first song. Are you ready?
Sure.
All right. That's probably like one of the best openings of any song on the planet. Right. I just
Right.
mean, like, it's such a good opening. I love Stevie Nicks. So what is kind of the background of that story that that you talked about a little bit in your book, or maybe you have a personal story behind it as well?
Right. So this is kind of a funny part in the book because the protagonist is pretty, egotistical and tries to run his own band and doesn't have a band manager yet. And they're always trying to do gimmicky things on stage just to make the concert more interesting. He's just got this one sidekick who has to travel around with him everywhere. And so he says, "All right, well, we're gonna release Doves. We're gonna sing just like a White Wing, we're gonna sing that song as a cover, and then I hired this lady to release Doves." And his sidekick is like, "This is an indoor venue. How are the doves gonna get back home?" And he's like, "I don't know, let her, that's her problem." Like, so these doves get caught in the rafters, and then the club owner puts a like 18-pound cat up, and the cat just starts killing all the doves. And then the cat reaches for the last dove and falls and dies. So they have SPCA and PETA now following their asses all around, saying, like, free, the dove's name is Sharon, free Sharon and all this. So, and that's the point in the book where his sidekick says, "I'm not doing this anymore," and gives him the card to this lady who said, "Hey, I'll be your band manager." And then that's how they get hooked up with Rachel, who becomes their band manager from then on. And she's a badass.
It. That's awesome. So obviously, I know you played in bands growing up. What's your very first musical instrument that you learned how to play?
Well, when I was a kid, I guess really the drums, actually, because all I needed was, I always wanted to be a drummer, and I just got a pair of drumsticks, and then I would just play on the sofa. I would put different pillows and things in the places where the drums should be. You'd be surprised, as ridiculous as that sounds, how helpful it was, when you actually sit down to a drum set. As long as you're getting the rhythms and you're feeling how you should be, moving your hands and hitting things and all of that, it really did help with rhythm. But my first kind of official instrument that I played in a band was bass.
Yeah.
So I consider myself a bass player.
So when you were playing the drums on cushions, what was your go-to drum song that you were always playing?
Oh, at that time, I was a big, well, when I was a really little kid, I was a Kiss fan.
Yeah.
And but in high school, I was a big Rush and Police fan, which is kind of nice because you get Stuart Copeland, who's more of a fr kind of a free
Yeah.
kind of player, and then you've got Neil Peart, who's just, this god of percussion, right? So those are two nice styles to follow.
Do you remember your first song that you learned on the drums?
No, I don't know. Probably something stupid, like some stupid Kiss song, Christine 16 or God of Thunders. I don't know. It's
So
funny. I went
what made you change from drums to bass?
Well, in our house, first off, a drum set is a pretty expensive thing to have. And I really didn't buy I didn't buy a bass until after high school. So during high school, I played sports, and I kind of felt like, with the whole marching band and all that, that I was behind all of
Yeah.
them, because I went to Catholic school and there was no band or anything. There were no instruments. So that was just something that I thought was a huge kind of miss. By the time I got to high school, it's like, well, I can't read music, I can't do all these things. So I just, played sports. But then after high school, I bought a bass, and it came to me, I think, fairly quickly with some lessons. And
What kind of music did your parents listen to when you were growing up?
that's a big part of the book too. My mom was a big, my mom kind of went through this like hippy dippy phase, and she kind of rebelled, and she was really big into Cat Stevens. We listened to all kinds of stuff. She would listen, she would, we had this stereo, she would blast like Fiddler on the Roof
Nice.
music. So we'd be hearing, like from Broadway plays. There was one that didn't make it into the book, but she would play this music. It was by these Belgian monks that was recorded in the Congo in the 1950s. called Misa Luba. And it's a, it was, I still have it. And it's incredible. But again, it was one of those things that I really couldn't find a way to get it into the book. But, you know, as a tribute to my mom, a major part of the story is the Cat Stevens song. He did the whole soundtrack to the movie Harold and Maude, which is this weird offbeat comedy, or I guess comedy slash romance. And that plays a big part in the book, is the song that ends that movie.
Yeah.
If you want to
I love that you grew up with a lot of different kinds of music in the household. You can kind of, from your playlist too, regardless if it's, you know, attached to a book, I'm assuming lots of these songs, you know, have like a more personal memory as well, not just for your book, right? So I love
exactly.
I love doing shows with people that have like this eclectic, totally different playlist. Like it's all over the place, because that's how I am with music too. And I can always tell it's always going to be a good show when their music is all over the place, opposed to, you know, if somebody just sends me, and I love Kiss, but like 12 Kiss songs, and it's like, hey, that's awesome that you love Kiss, but what else do you love? You know, like there's so much more to love. And speaking of Kiss, they're coming to Calgary. We're going to see them November 12th, which is so crazy. I'm so excited. I got like four seats.
You're going?
I'm going. Gene Simmons was having a hard time a little while ago, but we'll see if they make it. So I'm hoping that they go. So it'll be fun.
That's great. That's amazing.
Yeah. Right. Next song.
To the seasons of.
Nobody can beat Dolly Parton's voice. Like, it's just unreal. Beautiful song. Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
It's an amazing human. So, cost many colors.
Yeah. So this in the book, this is where their new band manager, Rachel, this is her idea. And, so what they do is they, as they're playing this song, Coat of Many Colors, they have this home economics teacher on the stage, and she's has a sewing machine, and she's frantically sewing this coat with all of these patches of cloth. And she sews this coat of many colors while they're playing the song, and they're soloing, and they have to solo longer because she's not finished with the coat. And then she finally finishes the coat of many colors, and then they auction that off at the gig. And this is when they're in around Nashville. And my sister lives in Mount Juliet, just outside of Nashville. And so I made that home ec teacher from that high school, and they auction the coat off and give the money to their high school program.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
What is your biggest musical influences in elementary, high school?
I think early on, I was a big, you know, Kiss, but more like my first album was Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon, that my brother had given me. And I think that was kind of a blessing of having a lot of older siblings.
Yeah.
If you're only seven and you're the oldest, well, you're listening to Sesame Street and things like that. But if you're seven and you have, you know, a 17-year-old brother, you're going to be listening to so. I was listening to all this like crazy stuff, but you know, he gave me Dark Side of the Moon, and actually we had this cool teacher, and he would let you bring an album. But when I brought that and we listened to Dark Side of the Moon, everybody was like, "You're so weird," because they were all listening to like disco. They were listening to like Casey and the Sunshine Band and all this stuff.
Yeah.
But in high school, yeah, I was like early U2 fan. Again, the Police. That was the first concert I ever saw was during that Police tour, which was
oh, that's awesome.
Incredible. Yeah, it was Oingo Boingo, Thompson Twins.
Wow.
Nice. The Fix, and then the Police.
Wow. What that a great lineup.
I know. And I kind of regret, since it was my first concert, I just thought, oh, this is what concerts are like. And now looking back, I think that may have been the greatest concert I ever saw in my life and didn't realize it.
That's right. It's so true, though.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I absolutely do know what you mean. My very first concert was Aerosmith and Iron Maiden.
Oh, wow.
Who would have thought like those two would ever be?
Yeah. Who opened up for whom?
Aerosmith opened up for Iron Maiden.
Whoa.
Yeah. It was so crazy. I was pretty young. I was like 9 or 10 years old. My dad took me. That was my very first time really meeting my dad. And that's what we went and did. And I was like, this is awesome. Right. Super fun and incredible concert. But that I feel like when we grew up, I felt like that's really when concerts were a lot of fun. Right.
Yeah.
My opinion anyways, I see concerts now and, you know, we were just in Las Vegas and we went to go see Punk Rock Bowling. And that was about 47 punk bands from back in the day. And it was awesome. Don't get me wrong. It was phenomenal. But I just like, it just wasn't there.
Yeah.
Oomph wasn't there. I love going and seeing old bands that have been around for like 20, 30 years where you can sing all their songs. And, you know, it was awesome. We had, you know, Suicidal Tendencies was playing and I thought it was so bizarre because they've been around for so long.
Mm-hmm.
They even put like a disclaimer. They were only doing their very first album. And I thought, how crazy to come and play a show like this and only do your first album. And no offense, I don't even remember their very first album. And I don't even think it was that popular. So to only come and do your first album, like it was.
I wonder why.
I don't know. And I think it was only him. I honestly think half of his children were playing. One was playing the guitar. I don't know for sure, but like they were young, like they could be his kids, right? Like
sure.
Guitar and playing basses and playing drum and he was singing. And I was like, oh my God, like all the albums you have and you're playing your very first album. It's like, and I don't even think that album went anywhere. So it's kind of like a kick in the face, right? Here you have all these other bands that have been around for like 30 years and they're all playing all random, all of their old stuff, but
yeah,
every single song. So
the stuff everybody would want to hear.
Yeah, it was really, really interesting. I love that your first concert was like that. That's most of the time I hear when I ask that question, it's like people are embarrassed because they're like, oh, it was like my mom took me to like, you know, the Backstreet Boys or like something like,
yeah,
it, they would probably never, ever.
Yeah. Opening act, The Wiggles.
Yeah, like you're like, oh wow, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Song. All right, now we're mixing it up a little bit.
Yeah, so this is Selena Quintanilla, who was, you know, tragically murdered. But she's kind of like a, you know, a goddess in the Spanish music world. So this was, this part of the book is when they go to they're up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin around the time of this German and polka festival. And a lot of Mexican music has those German roots. You know, you have tubas, you have that kind of umpa sound, you have accordions, and a lot of people don't know that, for example, during Oktoberfest in Germany, Mexican bands will go over there, right? And they do quite well. So this was really my attempt to talk about how different people, you know, music can bring different people together, and they end up meeting this lady who has a perfect voice and barely speaks any English at all. And the sidekick is like, well, first off, he's in love with her, but but the sidekick is like, we can make it work. She doesn't need to speak English, you know? And so that's the song that they play, because they say, you just tell us a song you want to play or you want to sing to, and we'll play it for you. And that's the song that she gives them.
Yeah. I remember seeing that movie, the documentary of her years ago.
Yeah.
So interesting. I didn't really click in until you seen that, until you said she was murdered. I was like, holy cow, that's been years since I've seen that. And then obviously just heard that again. That's.
Yeah. And, you know, J-Lo did a really good job. That's why I think there are so many just very mediocre music or movies about musicians, is because like, who's going to play Prince? You know,
I know.
Who's going to play David Bowie? It's just, it's very hard to do. And yeah, you almost need somebody who's, you need somebody who's as talented.
Yeah.
Like J-Lo to play her, who's going to play Tina Turner, you know?
I know.
And I mean, I think she did a really good job with that. I think the sad thing about Selena is that she was just getting big enough that she could have done anything.
Yeah.
Like if she had stayed alive, she might have done an album with Justin Timberlake or something. You know what I mean? She could have done anything she wanted because she really had to improve her Spanish. I mean, a lot of her first language was probably English, you know, and she was into hip hop. And if you watch the movie, that she was really not into the whole Mexican music thing. Her dad was just like pushing that on them because
it
would work, you know?
Yeah.
You know, it would work, but it was just interesting. I think it's tragic to think where her career might've gone in another, say, 10 years.
Yeah, for sure. I just finished watching a couple of weeks ago, a Tina Turner documentary that absolutely blew my mind. I knew a lot about her and how brutal her whole entire kind of music, that whole thing was.
Yeah.
I could not believe how much of that stuff they put in the documentary that I obviously did not know. And I'm sure there was a million times over. I think, you know, obviously they just do a piece of the abuse in there and then kind of took from that is how much of that was and how strong she came and just like watching that and seeing that the only thing that she cared about was her name, you know, and how he knew that I don't want to give that up. I can't, like, you know, I want to keep her. I want to keep that name. Just him knowing if she gets her name, she doesn't need him anymore, you know, and just like, an incredible story, and she was just such a inspiration for sure. Both women inspiration, right? For sure.
Yeah. And I think she seemed pretty humble too.
Yeah.
I just watched an old 60 Minutes interview that they had done with her quite a while back, and she seemed very, very down to earth. And you know, some people remember where they came from and they don't ever lose that.
Yeah, I love that about artists. Right. I was watching and I was a crazy, crazy Prince fan my whole entire life. And there was just like this little TikTok video on the other day. And they were talking about somebody. I can't even remember who it was. They were asking him, so what do you think about? And it wasn't Justin Timberlake, but it was something like that. They were like, so what do you think about this guy or gal? And he was like, oh, they're good, but do they play their musical instruments? And I just thought, and he just being so soft spoken how he was, it was like a super dig into that artist, but confident. He was like, yeah, that's good. But like, are they even playing their own music? And I thought, geez.
Yeah.
Like what? You're so right. Like, are they? Like, you played 17 instruments for crying out loud. You get to say that. You can go and totally diminish all of that for sure, 100%, because you have the confidence and you have the career and obviously the ability to totally go and destroy anything that they come back at you with.
Yeah, I remember someone asked Eric Clapton, you know, do you consider yourself the greatest guitar player alive right now? And he said, well, you need to go talk and see what Prince thinks about that. That's what Eric Clapton said.
Wow.
Oh, dang. Right. That's pretty high praise.
It is. That's very high praise.
Yeah.
Next song. All right, like I said, it's just, I'm excited to read your book and then go and listen to these songs that are attached to the stories that, you know, you're sharing here today.
Thank you. Yeah. So this is by Rachmaninoff. And there's a section in this piece that's considered one of the hardest piano pieces for anybody to play. And so this is one of the flashbacks in the book to the protagonist's mother, who was a concert piano major in college in this very prestigious school, and you have to play a piece to graduate, right? And so that's the piece that she chose, and yet she ends up having this enigmatic, cool young professor agrees to help her because she realizes that it was just hubris, and she really chose, she bit off way more than she could chew, and she's like, I can't do this. And so this young guy, this cool professor, agrees to help her, and they end up having an affair, and she gets pregnant. And so in the end, you know, this guy, his name's Wood's mother ends up being this very, very bitter person because she has this young child, you know, out of wedlock. The professor got fired. They ended up paying him a bunch of money to keep his mouth shut, and he moved away. So she didn't end up getting a degree. She didn't end up getting the guy, the money, nothing. So she's just this very angry single mom who teaches piano on the side, you know. So it explains a lot. I mean, she plays a big role in the book. And a lot of the book is really, it's really about family and relationships. It's not just, it's kind of told through the lens of this guy who's traveling from town to town and having, you know, concerts and doing all the cool stuff and drinking and smoking weed or whatever. But that's not really what the book is about. It's really about relationships with very complicated people.
Oh, that's interesting. So I know you've kind of traveled the world. I want you to like kind of think of, you know, Russia against Tokyo. What would be some really, really big differences there?
So there's a section in the book where they go to Estonia. And I never went to Estonia, but I went to Kazakhstan right after the wall came down. And, you know, my passport, this is how soon after it was, my passport is still, the stamp is still the Soviet Union passport. Oh, wow. It's still the CCCP, you know. And so that was just very dark and gray. But it didn't make sense. If you look at it on the map, it wouldn't make sense for them to travel that far. And so I switched it to Estonia. And also in the 1990s, because it wasn't like everything changed immediately. So I guess in Estonia, they had this series of concerts every summer called Glasnost Rocks. And like, you know, Bjork and the Sugar Cubes went there. I'm a huge Public Image Limited fan, you know, John Lydon. They played there in front of like 100,000 people. So I kind of tied it into that. And then this is my kind of experience told through the, you know, the lens of them going to play this big gig for the CIA. They actually get recruited by the CIA to go and to go and play a gig and try to, you know, get something done for them. So there's a little bit of a, this is not certainly not a spy story, but there is a little bit of a spy element to why they're there. So they're just basically being used by the US government.
So if you're going to describe Russia compared to Tokyo, what is that looking at?
Sorry. I forgot that. I mean, the time that I was in Russia, they were going through so much change. There were a lot of drunk people everywhere.
Oh, really?
Yeah. When even at like at 10 a.m., you'd see people like passed out drunk. So it was a pretty dark, pretty dark time. And then when I was in Tokyo, you know, when I lived there, it was really before the internet really became big. So, I mean, Tokyo is, it's always going to be a very cool city. And I mean, all of Japan is really. And I think a good description of is it's a very big, it's a very crowded city where people understand that being polite matters. And that the only way you're going to like move people around to get them to their job in the morning is for everybody to think about everybody else. And I think that's one thing that I wish, you know, we had more of. Here.
Yeah.
Well, it's just that consideration for other people, for your neighbors and things like that.
Is that one thing that you learned and like obviously brought back to the US?
I think so. Even little things like here, if I open the door for you, you would say thanks. In Japan, if I open the door for you, you would say sorry. because you're thinking about me opening the door.
Oh, interesting.
Right. So it's this constant attitude of how am I inconveniencing the people around me, right?
So is there a theory to make, I'm supposed to make your life easier, just but not really thinking about making your life easier?
I think so, yeah. Yeah, even the way, so this is kind of a funny story, but when people are working together and then somebody clocks out and leaves, just grabs their coat and walks out, they'll say like, "Osakinishi tsureshimasu," you know, and you just hear that over and over again. But what it literally means is, I'm leaving before you, so I'm rude.
Oh, wow.
So can you imagine somebody in Calgary going, "I'm leaving before you, so I'm rude. Okay, see you tomorrow." Like, that's literally what it means. That's literally what you're saying.
It's, that's so crazy.
So it gives you a lot of insight when you start to learn the language more and more and you understand what things actually mean in their literal sense.
Yeah. What's the weirdest thing you ate when you were there?
I wasn't, you know, too adventurous. I didn't eat any like live fish or whatever. Probably uni, which I was never a big fan of, which is like sea urchin.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. But I mean, I love Japanese food, but I wouldn't try.
So you tried sea urchin because my grandparents owned a fishing resort and they had a bunch of Japanese clients this one time. And in BC, the sea urchins are all over the place. So I was super young, probably 8 or 9. And I was just on the dock and I was just like scooping up sea urchins. Me and my girlfriend were just, that's kind of what we did. And we would scoop them up and then watch them walk around and then kick them back into the water, like thinking nothing of it. Well, they started coming in from fishing and they were like, "Oh my God." And so they made my grandpa like cut them open and they were eating the eggs out of that. And I was like, this is like crazy. Like, this is insane.
Exactly.
It was like the best thing. They're like right on the ocean. This is like prime seafood here. And I was like, I never really thought about that until you just brought it up now. I'm like, oh, that's interesting. I didn't even click in until now. So.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a pretty wild.
Yeah.
That's a wild story. That's a keeper.
It is. I love this band so much.
Who is this?
Probably the best albums out there are Fleetwood Mac albums, right? I just like one of my, you know, my brother bought me a record player probably about 9 years ago because I just love LPs so much. And and I just remember being out and about and I'm like, I want to just go buy a record and just kind of sit down and have a glass of wine. And I thought, geez, back, like the best record to go buy is a Fleetwood Mac album. Right. It's like every single song on there, you know, they just were so good. Like, I love that about Fleetwood Mac. Like, just every album is just so good, one hit after another. And yeah, I love it.
Yeah. And then you hear that they were, you know, going through divorces and all, you know, with each other. And just crazy. I mean, this part of the book, I've always loved that song, Tusk. And then when you hear, oh, they recorded that with the USC, you know, University of Southern California marching band. It's a great video. It's one of my favorite rock videos of all time because it shows Stevie Nicks. I guess she twirled baton in high school because she knew what she was doing. If you watch that video, she's like, okay, I guess she was a baton twirler. So in that part of the book is because I tried to touch on different kinds of music and different kinds of musicians. And so this is when they go to Louisiana and they end up playing with Jesse, his sidekick, Jesse's old high school band. And that's it's run by the scariest band teacher in the history of planet Earth. It's a scary guy who's like, I use all the terminology from Apocalypse Now when he's talking about Colonel Kurtz, you know, that's how he talks about this band teacher, and he's just so afraid of the man. And, but yeah, they go and play with his band, and he talks about just, you know, the experience. And, yeah. And I actually sent the book to, I mentioned a real high school, called St. Chalmette. It's one of the high schools, one of the areas of New Orleans that was completely flooded after Hurricane Katrina. And I sent a couple of books to their high school library. Wow. Yeah.
You talk about the apocalypse a little bit. What would be your weapon of choice if you had to choose a weapon just to carry around during an apocalypse?
Oh my gosh. Probably a jetpack to just leave, you know, just I'm like, I want to be 200 yards that way. Just.
Oh my God. So do you have any band t-shirts still left that you got from a concert?
I don't think that I got from a concert, but our old drummer, who's a great guy named John, he sent me a Public Image Limited, because he knows I'm a big fan. He sent me a Public Image Limited t-shirt last year, or a year or two ago, so that's still in good condition. I'm trying to think of any other cool. I had a nice Police shirt. I had a U2 under a Blood Red Sky shirt. That was a great shirt.
I know. I wish we could go back in time and get all of that kind of stuff, because I feel like every time you move or purge or whatever, you're just kind of like, no, I don't want that. I was doing my pictures a couple months ago, and I have like binders and binders and binders of like ticket stubs. And I was like, this is so I thought what it started was I was going to go find that and then like take pictures of them and then like do some creative stuff for the podcast on them. And then spiraled into like looking and purging all over this stuff. And I was like, geez, I have like pics from like old school and old drum sets, like our drum sticks and all of this stuff. But I miss all my band shirts. I miss all those.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, and those ticket stubs, I mean, that's just way cool, because you can kind of like, since there are dates on there.
Yeah.
You can kind of, because it's like, did I see The Cure after I saw Dolly or who? And then you can kind of put it all and you can remember where was I living at that time and who went to the concert with me.
Yeah. Yeah. It's really interesting. Do you remember the first cassette that you bought?
The first cassette. I know. Well, here's going way back. When I was a little kid, we had an 8-track tape.
Yeah.
In an 8-track player in a Ford Pinto. This just little disaster of a car. And I know in there we had Pat Benatar. Nice. We had Fleetwood Mac. We had that Elton John album where he's wearing like a white tuxedo with a cane.
Okay, yeah.
Had that one. We had Police Zenyatta Mondatta, which was kind of an obscure. So we only had like, you know, five or six. And then we had the Doobie Brothers. My mom was a Doobie Brothers fan. So that was kind of funny. I actually met, when I was in Japan, I met these kids, these high school kids that were in a Doobie Brothers cover band.
No way.
Yeah. Like, you know, they were only like 15 years old. And they're like,
interesting.
You don't know me, but I'm your brother. Like trying to sing Michael McDonald and shit. I was like, what in the hell?
That is so hilarious. Especially,
yeah.
How interesting. Like of all bands to pick.
Right. And I was like, you know, they broke up 10 years ago. You know, they broke up around the time you were all born. That's the great thing about travel, is just you really don't know what to expect or what you'll find, you know, and just little weird subcultures and things like that.
Yeah. All right, next song. It's a good thing.
Yeah. Miss Barbara Lynn. So actually, the first time I ever heard this song, I remember my buddies and I were on some little trip and I went in the gas station and I bought this. It was a reggae compilation. And so I heard the reggae version of this song from some band that I hadn't even heard of. And then I ended up hearing the original Barbara Lynn version. I think she's still alive. And she is a very good guitar player. But in this part of the story is when they go play at a women's prison. And Wood and then Jesse, they're kind of opposites. You know, Wood is from this rich family. He's an only child, doesn't know who his dad is. And then Jesse is this African-American / Choctaw First Nations guy from a huge family that's a functional family. His dad's around, aunts and uncles, siblings. And they get in this huge argument on the way to the women's prison, really about justice and about, you know, is there a system that's just like funneling people into prison? And then he's coming at it from this kind of rich white guy. Well, everybody's responsible for their own actions, right? Like nobody forced you to become a drug dealer. They get in this huge argument and then they go to the women's prison and play this gig. And he ends up meeting some of the, kind of like when Johnny Cash went to Folsom Prison, which is very close to here. We have a little sailboat that's docked at the Folsom Lake right outside of the prison.
No way.
Yeah, so I'm always watching if I'm going to be sailing. If somebody's like swimming towards me in an orange jumpsuit, I'm be like, hey, man, just back off. I cannot help you today. So anyway, they play this gig at that prison. And then Jesse, this girl that he had a crush on in high school, he realizes like she's in the prison. So they end up singing that duet together because they call these prisoners up on the stage and they all like, who can play bass? Who can play drums? And they kind of fashion this band together just for fun. And he ends up singing You'll Lose a Good Thing with that girl that he had a crush on. Yeah.
How long have you been sailing for?
Probably. Well, when I went to Indiana University, I took a sailing class. So I learned the basics there. Those were just on little tiny sailboats. And then we bought a boat probably 5 years ago.
Yeah.
It's a little sailboat, but we can sleep underneath it. We go out, just, you know, find a little cove, drink wine, listen to music.
That's beautiful.
Chill out.
Of being on the water. We have a boat too, but not a sailboat, just a regular boat. But lately I've been seeing a lot of sailboats around and just the whole concept. I actually just want to be on one and just kind of experience that. I just feel like it would be just like magical in a sense.
It is very, it's very cool. And yeah, it's just very kind of quiet and serene. And the idea that you can just, well, also the idea that you're connecting with how people used to do it way back in the day when they didn't have a motor if they wanted one.
Yeah.
Right. And then there's certain things that certainly limit you. Like you cannot sail into the wind, really. And then the wind might just die and you're out in the middle, you're out in the middle of nowhere. You know, it's not a Jimmy Buffett song when your wife's drunk and not happy that you're not moving, throwing a beer at you. Like it's not fun then. It's like, oh.
Do you bring your dog sailing?
Sometimes. Yeah. Yeah. We have little, we have these, I guess, doggy life vests, and they have, it's cool because they have a shark fin that comes up so that you can see them in the water. Yeah. But it's absolutely hilarious. They get just crazy. We have the Basset Hound, Margaret Thatcher, and then we have a Shih Tzu named Cece, and they just go bonkers when they're on the boat. So
our dog goes bonkers. We have a Mastiff, and he goes ape shit on the boat, and it drives us absolutely crazy. Runs back and forth constantly.
Right.
And we are trying to get him to learn because he loves the boat. Okay, so we bought this dog. We were told super lazy. You know, farts all the time, not energetic, like perfect for our lifestyle, right? This dog, like, we're 5K a day, we're going here, super energetic, as obsessed with the water, like literally obsessed with the water. We cannot go around water without him wanting to get on in the water. And then so, like, totally whips our world all upside down because we're thinking lazy dog. And we can't get him to jump off the boat. He will not jump off the boat. So we have this, like, little prop that we walk down, and it's like every summer we're like coaxing him, right? Hey, you got to learn this. So we feel like this is the year. It's been 9 years. We feel like this is the year.
Get your ass off the boat.
Fucking ass off the boat. So, like, we literally have to park the boat and have him go out there for he can. It's amazing how much you cater to your dogs. Like, you're like, oh, let's stop.
Oh, yeah.
Go park for we can let him off and play in the water. It's like ridiculous. It's like, I need to play on the boat, not you. Like, what the hell is going on right now?
Yeah. What's your dog's name?
His name is Bane.
Bane.
Yeah.
The bane of your existence.
We're watching my brother's three chihuahuas right now. He's in Norway and he missed his flight. I thought we were going to be home free. So we have four effing dogs in this house right now. Three of them are chihuahuas. And we're not little dog people at all, obviously. We have a mastiff. And so it's like there's three female chihuahuas and then Bane, this massive dog. So it's like hilarious to watch.
Wow. He's got like a little harem.
It's so funny. We took them for a walk yesterday. And my husband was like, I have never been so embarrassed at all ever walking. Because we, you know, like these chihuahuas are like six.
Yeah.
So they're all like crisscrossing everywhere, sure. And Bane's out and they're watching him. And it's just like a clusterfuck because you're like, it would be like the worst dog walker in the planet because the dogs are like crisscrossing everywhere. But
you should dress up like Kardashians and just go all in on it for your neighbors and just own it for a while.
I have seen a couple people that are just kind of like, you know, they're driving like, what the hell is going on? And then you forget because you have this big dog and, you know, you're going for a serious walk and then you're like, oh, you're kind of dragging the other ones. It's like, they're exhausted. They're 6 pounds, like 10 feet. They slept all day. I'm like, maybe we shouldn't have took them for such a long walk. I don't know how long they can walk for. I'm just assuming, right?
But right. It gets to be a bit much.
Yeah, it does get to be a bit much. All right, next one. It's happy hour again. I think I'm up. Everybody loves happy hour, right?
The House Martins. Yeah, so a good friend of mine, he spent two summers in England, and he was in Leeds, which I guess is a pretty rough place. And then he told me about the city of Hull, which I guess is really pretty dangerous, at least when he was there. I'm not sure about now. And it turns out the House Martins are from Hull, and they had that. There was an album, House Martins album, called London Nil, Hull 4, like a soccer score, right? And I thought it would be funny because that's such a jangly, happy song. That's like Walking on Sunshine vibes, you know? And again, this protagonist, right, he doesn't know, where is he? There he is. This guy, you know, he didn't have a father around. He doesn't have brothers or siblings. So he doesn't know how to fight. And so they try to play that song at a pub in Hull. And the crowd just attacks them and showers them with beer. And then he gets mad after getting hit in the head with a beer and gets in a fight with this guy and gets the living shit beat out of him. And then that leads to them, the other guy, his sidekick, Jesse, really like showing him how to kind of take care of himself and to throw his first real punch and defend himself in the fight, you know? So the book is also about friendship and about mentoring and learning different things from the people around you and, yeah, humility.
What did you love the most about being in those bands that you were in?
I think just being creative and working together to make a song and to make a song that would work. And because what you end up with is with all of these little pieces of songs, right? And this one might be an intro, or it could be a full song, and to kind of put this whole puzzle together with, you know, with people that inspire you. Like the band, the main band that I was in, there were only three of us, and the drummer was incredible. He could play all of the, his idol was Neil Peart, so he could play all of the Rush stuff. Just a really good guy. And he's the one who bought me the t-shirt. And then the guitar player was, you know, he was, had his own style and very, very interesting. So I was always just trying to like keep up with them, because they had both been playing for years, years longer than I had. And I would learn things from the guitar player, and, you know, he would teach me little techniques and stuff. So I was always just trying to kind of keep up with them. And there's nothing like being on stage. It's just crazy. You know, it kind of,
and watching people sing your songs and cheering for you, like, like
rooting for you. Yeah. That's Margaret Thatcher. Sorry.
That's okay. What musician would you love to meet, dead or alive?
What musician?
Yeah.
Would I love to meet? I have mixed feelings about this. I've thought about this a lot. I'm a huge Brian Ferry fan.
Okay.
I would love to meet Brian Ferry. On the other hand, he seems to be a pretty shy person. So you have to understand the reality that this person may just like stare into their cup of tea the entire time you're there, and they may not even talk to you.
Right? I feel like he would. You know, a lot of people want to go and meet their heroes or meet people that they idolize and look up to. And since, you know, this will be my third season's coming up on this podcast.
Yeah.
It is crazy when I interview artists compared to like just regular people. Like it's night and day. Like it's night and day, because it's like you are putting yourself in this environment where you want to be out there and maybe not necessarily recognized, but probably recognized. You want people to know your name. You want, you know, you want to show off your creativity. But then like inside, it's almost like this so insecure. It's insane. And I see that so much where I'm like, wow, I would have never thought that. So I always think that when I think of, oh my God, one day, you know, interview whoever is on my kind of top 10 list. But then I get nervous about it, because it's like, you know, are they going to be spontaneous with me? Is it going to be like push and pull kind of conversation? Are they going to be so strict? Because I find a lot of artists are like that too. They're scared to get out of their, I don't want to say out of their comfort zone, but I find nowadays people are really censoring themselves with everything. They're afraid to swear or be sarcastic, or, you know, or they mention something like, well, I don't mean it like that, and I don't want anybody to take offense. It's got to be exhausting to constantly have to watch what they say all the time.
Yeah. And I think they've probably been burned, you know, once you've been burned. And there's a part in the book where the, you know, where it shows, you know, things being taken out of context and whatnot. And I remember reading, I like Lloyd Cole, and I was on his website, and he had a little Q&A section, and somebody asked, you know, like, hey, you're coming to my town. Can we go out for coffee, or can I buy you a beer? Or he likes to play golf, you know, can I take you to golf? His answer I thought was very interesting, because he said, you don't really understand how it feels to be sitting across the table from somebody who, they know your birthday, they know how many siblings you have, they know all this bizarre stuff about you. You don't know jack shit about them. That's got to be a very uncomfortable place to be. You know, if I know that Morrissey is a Sagittarius and is, you know, he got in a car accident when he was 9 and he doesn't even know my name, that's got to be a little, it's certainly not, you know, an even playing field, especially I think what happens in interviews is they're like, oh, how's your album and everything. And they're just having this friendly conversation, and they go, let's go back to the rape allegation. You know, and they're like, what?
They're like, whoa. I really think I want to talk about that.
Yeah. And this is why they say, well, these are the four things I won't talk about. And, you know, stuff like that. And I guess I'm not really surprised, You know, I'm still in this place. Like, I wrote this book, but nobody knows who I am. Like, nobody. So I'm still speaking very freely. But what if you became super famous and then, you know, you kind of got burned by something or a bad situation? What would you, how would you react after that?
Yeah, it's the world that we live in is so interesting for that reason, you know. And obviously, I'm not super famous either. So when I get people on here and they talk about stalkers or, you know, people that are being rude on their social media, my first instinct is like, block them, right? Like, why deal with them? Just block them. Like, who cares? Like, I don't care. If somebody was ever to say something bad about my podcast and I don't want to deal with you, I'm just going to block you. Like, that's part of it. I can just block you. I don't need to deal with you. But that's how my mind works, right? So obviously there's the other side theory that I haven't had to experience yet where, you know, they could say, well, easily this is why you wouldn't do this or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. Reactions like, just get rid of them. I don't need them. I don't need
them. Especially if you have 300,000 followers.
Yeah. It's like, who cares?
Right. I can
tell Sally to stop. You know, I had an interview early today and there were the caves and there were like, or the calves, and they're like awesome guys. And I was saying, so are you guys getting like a lot of stalkers? And he was like, it's so funny. We had, you know, we keep getting this one girl that's coming to the show. And, you know, the first couple of times we're just like, hey, yeah, that's awesome. We put her on the guest list and she stayed up all night with her girlfriends and came to the show. And he goes, who knows, maybe 3 months from now, we might have a restraining order. I don't really know, but right now it's kind of cool. And I'm like, yeah, it is cool, but you don't know where it will go.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's interesting. They were called the Cavs.
Yeah. From Manchester. Really good.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Super funky.
Oh yeah. War is a great California band. This is when they go to Estonia and they're like, he's like, what are we going to play with musicians in Estonia right after the wall came down and everything? And this is when his sidekick goes, man, we're going to drop the funk on these dudes. So, because at first he's like, well, maybe we should play, you know, Tchaikovsky or something. It's like, we're going to get laughed off the stage and we try to play some Russian composer. Like, all they do is stand in lines to get bread and listen to classical music. Like, we're going to get ridiculed. So that's when he's like, okay, we're going to play. And then they end up playing with all these Estonian musicians and they play that song, Slipping Into Darkness. So I've always loved that. I mean, my brother was a huge War fan and, you know, they were the ones who sang Lowrider, you know, Lowrider. So yeah. they're just a great, great band all around.
So I know you've obviously wrote this book, but have you wrote some more books? Like what do you got kind of coming up for yourself right now?
Yeah. So I'm working on the next books. I'm also a painter. Okay. So this is the love letter to musicians. And then the next one is kind of the love letter to artists, but the next one will be a lot darker. It's about, think of like, you know who Bob Ross is?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
So like if Bob Ross borrowed money from Tony Soprano, like, and his life went very dark, very fast. So, but each book will be set in a different country. Like Italy. I just got back from Italy. And so I was doing some of the research there. And yeah, so you'll learn about, and he leads groups, you know, he's kind of a tour guide / painting instructor. So, and it'll take place not, I like things that take place prior to the internet, right?
Yeah.
I remember in high school when I was an exchange student in Chile. And like, if you were lost, you're just lost.
Yeah.
You can't just pick up your phone and go, where am I supposed to be? I mean, you're just
lost. Figure it out.
Yeah. And if you don't understand the explanation that people are giving you, then you're really lost.
But I feel like you learn so much.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
Do you have a website? Where can we kind of find you, stalk you, buy your books, all of that kind of stuff?
Yeah. So on Amazon, my author name is JP Lane. And then on Facebook, you can just look at Art of JP Lane.
Oh.
That's everything from like Facebook to I think Instagram. It's part of JP Lane is everything. Yeah.
What do you love most about being a writer?
I like developing the characters to the point where the dialogue just started to come very naturally because I already knew who they were. I already knew who Jesse was. I already had a sense of who his mom was and Rachel, the band manager. I mean, even the dog, you know, the dog is a major character in the book because that was the vehicle, right? So we don't really know what somebody's thinking, but you'll say anything to a dog. So that was the way to explain what is actually happening in this guy's head and how he actually feels about his place in the world and you know, what his thoughts are is because he's just driving to the next gig with a basset hound. And he's like, Margaret, you know, here's how I had a falling out with my uncle. You know, he yeah. got me into a good college and then I dropped out and we just, you know, we never had a relationship to prop up anymore. And so he's just kind of venting and speaking out loud. So that's what I loved. And also just what they call writing into the dark, where it's not so planned out. You just know what the basics of the scene are, and then you just start writing. And I actually write, I write longhand wow. onto paper, and then I type that in
wow.
to the computer, because then it just flows, and I don't see all these squiggly lines, because, you know, do you need a comma or not, or whatever. Yeah. When I'm writing, I just write, and that helps a lot to just let it just kind of flow. And then after that, it's just a lot of editing, right?
What would you say to somebody if they wanted to get, like, had this concept they wanted to write, where should they start?
What I did was to work backwards. It's like a movie, you know, a lot of movies, they just don't have a great ending. And so it's like, where is this all going to end? And one of the things that I struggled with was when you think of the character arc, you have, for my book and this guy, you have somebody living a pretty charmed life. And I thought, well, that's going to be a problem because he's just this kind of cool rock star, and you're going to get to page 100 and go, well, big deal. There's no conflict here. Like, yeah. You know, I'll just put down the book. And so, you know how a lot of movies start out with the ending, right? So it'll just give you like 1 minute of the beginning of the movie and you see somebody being shot. Right. Yeah. You realize, like, or even at the beginning of the movie, like American Beauty, where he's just like, you know, in 1 year, yeah. I'll be dead. So you already know how it's going to end. And I think that's a very acceptable way to start a movie. And that's why the book starts in the way that it does. I think it's only 2 pages of the book. It's like he wakes up, he's in a hospital in Japan, jacked up and handcuffed to the bed. It's like, oh,
what happened?
Right. And then it goes back to like 2 years before. Yeah. It gives you a sense that there's this kind of this impending doom for this person.
That's interesting. All right, we're on your last song. You ready?
I'm ready.
I believe in you.
Yeah. So one of the things that was important to me was to include artists that are not huge. And that do you have any musicians where you think like, why isn't this person more famous?
Yep.
And I don't think, you know, Talk Talk was a band that nobody knew about. I mean, they were on MTV and things like that, but when you listen to just how beautiful some of their songs were. And that video in particular is very beautiful. It'll make you cry. And it was written for Mark Hollis's older brother, who was a heroin addict. Mm. And I think died, I think he OD'd. And so it's a very, very beautiful, sad song. And the way it ties into the book, because this gets into like the homophobia that you would have seen in the 1990s, right? That's where this all takes place. And you have the sidekick Jesse, who would rather have them think that he's on hard drugs than have them think that he's gay. Like, think about that for a second.
Yeah.
So they see in the book, you know, he sees this, you know, like strange man going into his room because they're, you know, they're touring it in hotels and stuff like that. And he's like, well, what's this guy? Well, he's my dealer. He'd rather have him think that he's a heroin dealer than he's my lover. Right. And so it just kind of a reflection on the way things were back then. And I think the decisions that, you know, that people had to make. And so in the way that kind of the song ties in is they sing songs in a few instances in the book, they sing songs to each other to kind of send messages to each other during a gig. And he sings that song, Wood, the main guy, sings that song, really, which is about heroin addiction, to Jesse because he thinks he's using drugs.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm excited to read your book, right? I'm excited, and I appreciate you coming and spending some time here on Music Junkies today and sharing a little bit about, you know, obviously your history in music, but a lot about the book, which I think is incredible. And I'm excited to read it, right? So thank you so much for being a guest today on Music Junkies. But before I let you go, I'd love for you to leave us with some words of wisdom.
Oh, my Lord. Well, you were talking about, you know, writers and whatnot. And I would just encourage people to not try and follow trends. I'm on these Reddit groups, you know, of writers and all kinds of Reddit groups. And it seems to me, as I read the comments, a lot of people are they're thinking about, well, I need to be writing a book that everybody's already buying. Because obviously, if everybody else is buying them, then I can just jump on that bandwagon. But that's not an interesting life, right? If you're trying to create music just to get famous, or you're trying to write a book, I told somebody recently, like, no literary agent in their right mind would have thought that J.K. Rowling's idea was a good idea, right? You're gonna write a book about a 9-year-old boy with a wand? I mean, who's gonna read that? Adults aren't gonna read that. Girls aren't gonna read that. Even little boys might not read it. I mean, you know, at first glance, it would seem like, okay, you need to be writing something else. You know, self-help books are huge. I would recommend that. That's probably what you would logically sit down and tell J.K. Rowling to do with her career. Then thank God she didn't listen to people like that.
She right? could write a really hell of a Harry Potter self-help book, though.
There's probably one in the works.
Like, you know what? I'm just
that's where the money is.
These out there, may as well try it.
Exactly.
Thank you so much.
She needs a little more money.
She does, just a tad more, just a tad more.
Yeah. Well, thank you. This has been wonderful. I appreciate the opportunity.
Yeah, I appreciate you too.